Hello everyone, my name is Alejandro Garcia and I'm going to talk about Python game development. Here you have my Twitter and email, so if you have any question or something to ask me or whatever you want, just feel free to send me an email or whatever, okay? So the contents of this talk is, first I'm going to talk about how Python is being used currently in video games, and I'm going to show you my own game framework that I called it Kobra. Okay, so how Python is currently used in video games? There are two ways of using Python in video games. Okay, the first one is using Python as a secondary language for scripting, and here the main game is programmed in another language like C++, for example. And the Python interpreter is indeed inside the application. Okay, so the application calls that Python code for certain actions, such as what happens when two actors collide, or so on. But well, this wastes Python potential. We don't use Python as much as we should, and Python is designed to be extended, not embedded. Okay, so some examples of games that use Python this way as a secondary language for scripting is Sid Meier's Civilization 4 and Mountain Blade. The other way of using Python for video games is using it as a primary language. Here, the Python interpreter runs the main game loop, okay, and some bindings for improving performance can be used, such as C++ or so on. We have a little slower than the previous example. Some examples of games that use Python as a primary language are EVE Online and Metin 2. Next, these are the most used Python libraries as a Python for primary language. We have Pygame, that is very easy and very popular, you may know about it. And we have Cocos2D, that is a bit more complex than Pygame, but it has more features. For 3D, we have Blender 3D, that, as you may know, it's a 3D modeling tool, but it also has a game engine, okay? But the downside that Blender 3D has is that it's GPL, so we can make commercial games from it. And we have Panda 3D, that is a Disney creation framework that was used for their games such as Pirates of Caribbean. So, developing games with Python. Python is very good language, such as C# or JavaScript. Okay. But the only problem is that there are very few game frameworks. C# is used for Unity, that is very popular. JavaScript is used for web games, but Python is not currently used, not because it's not good, it's because there aren't any game frameworks. And some of these frameworks are a bit limited or have an old architecture. So I'm going to explain Kobra, that is my game engine. So it's an open source 3D game video game framework, okay, and it's three things: dynamic, efficient, and easy. Okay, so why is it dynamic? It is dynamic because it uses an ECS architecture. I'm going to explain later what this ECS architecture is. Okay, so it's designed for real world game development. As you may know, in the real game development teams, the game changes a lot because mainly of designers. Okay, this architecture helps us to change the game more easily, and this makes our game easily adaptable and extendable. So you may ask now, what is this entity component system? ECS stands for entity component system. Okay, so I'm going to show you an example. Here is, for example, let's think that we are working for EA and we are developing Star Wars, the new Star Wars Battlefront. So we have our game entity, and from then we extend our ships, and that ship can be either enemy ships or player ships. And these enemy ships can either be enemy X-wing or Y-wing, and the same with the player ship. We are very happy, our game runs very well, and suddenly our dear game designer comes and says, "Hey, what's up, programmer? We have to change the game, so now we want a lead ship." And then, well, we just have to rethink again all the architecture, we have to rewrite a lot of things, and this is the new architecture that again we have with an A ship, a C, and so on. And it's very probable that our game designer will come again and change our game over and over. So I wonder, is there a better way? Well, I have the pleasure to introduce you to the Entity Component System. It is used in modern game engines such as Unity 3D or Unreal Engine 4. And the basic concept is that the game entities that goes on our game are just a list containing components that make up that entity. Nothing more. It's just a list. Okay, so our previous example, our enemy X-Wing will be a game entity that has an enemy control because it's controlled by the enemy. It has a missile shooter because it shoots missiles, and it has a thruster movement because it moves forward. So these components communicate with each other via messages. So here, for example, our component enemy control wants to move forward. So the messages are sent to all entity components and then are consumed if needed. So the missile shooter receives move forward, but because he doesn't need to know if it's moving forward, then it ignores it. But our thruster movement says, "Oh, okay, so you want to move forward? I'll do it." And our X-Wing will move forward. So our architecture of our previous example will look like this. Here we have our enemy X-Wing. That is a game entity that has a control, missile shooter, a thruster movement, as explained before. And the only difference from the Y-Wing is that the missile shooter is replaced with blast shooter. So making this with components, we can just reuse these components in different entities. And here, for example, the player X-Wing and the enemy Y-Wing, the only difference is that it's controlled with an AE and the player is controlled with keyboard control. And the same goes with Y-Wing. So what do we achieve with this entity component system? The enemy AE doesn't need to know anything about the entity weapon, or even if it has one. He just sends the message, and if there is something like a missile or blast or whatever, it will shoot, for example. If there is nothing, it will do nothing. So we can quickly switch the blast with missile without changing anything of the code, making the code much more flexible to changes. And our friends, the designers, won't hurt us as much as they usually do. So I talk about entities, I talk about components. Now I'm going to talk about the systems. Okay, so components don't do the hard work. Instead, they send commands to the systems. These commands are queued, okay, and then later on they are executed in different threads. This allows to use multiple cores using the full matching potential. And we don't have to, because each system does a separate thing, we don't have to worry about interlocks at all. So core is efficient. Why is it efficient? Because it has a C++ core, okay, and it's multi-core. So here's Kobra. Uses Python, and Python communicates with C++ that has components and system. You can also program your own components in Python or C++ and your systems on C++ or Python. And you may ask now, what about the Jill? Who doesn't know what the Jill is? Jill? Who doesn't? Okay. The GIL stands for Global Interpreter Lock. It's an implementation feature of CPython that doesn't allow us to run on more than one core, okay? So how do we solve this? Well, Kobra is written in C++ mostly. So this is how the main game loop goes, okay? For each entity in Python, we update it, components, we enqueue commands to the systems, and then when everything is done, we update the systems. Okay, and for the update, we will go to C++ and spawn a thread for each core of the system. After that, we update that system and we join. And we can go back to Python without breaking anything of the shield. This runs over and over on the game. So Kobra is easy. Way is easy. I was inspired by Django, okay, to make this framework. So I'm going to explain now a little example of how to make a simple project with Kobra. This is a simple Kobra project, okay? We have five files. We have behaviors, controller, entities, scenes, and settings. In the entity file, we define each entity and the components it will have. Here, for example, I'm making a cube that it has three components. It has a Cartesian transform. This allows this entity to be placed in the world of the scene. And a mesh renderer that allows us to draw a 3D model. In this example, I'm drawing a cube mesh. And a behavior that makes the cube to rotate. These are the most important components that Kobra has. It doesn't read. For space transform, we have a Cartesian transform that allows to, as I explained before, it allows that entity to be placed in our world. A polar transform that is just the same, but instead of using a Cartesian transform, it's used a polar transform from the origin, or a screen transform that is a transformation in the screen space, and this can be used for user interface things. So these are the rendering. Okay, sorry for this. We have mesh renderer that is for rendering meshes. We have a mesh animator that animates with that mesh, and we have billboard renderer that will render a billboard, and a billboard is just a plane that always faces to the player. Okay, so for physics, we have rigid body, soft body, and box collide, spherical collide for defining what kind of collisions we will have. And for audio, we have audio source that is from where the audio is being played, and the listener that in most of the case it will be our player. And there are much more components that you can use in Kobra. So behaviors. In the behaviors file, we define the behaviors. Behaviors are components with predefined messages. The most important ones are start, update, and input. In the start, it calls when the entity is created. Update calls in each tick of the game, and input is when an input in the game happens. So with Kobra, sending messages is very easy. We just call set of components, now the name of the message, and here we put which variables for output we want from that component. And here in the keyword arguments, we put the input variables. I'm going to explain now, okay? Here's our last example, rotating behavior that just makes that entity to rotate. So here in the update that runs on each tick, I'm sending a message to get the current rotation. And as you can see here, I'm creating a tick that will be the output for that message. And now I will have here my rotation, and with that speed, I'm going to update it. And now I'm sending this message, set transform, with our new rotation.
It is also possible, if you don't like to send messages, to get a specific component and call a specific function on it. So you can just get the transform and call get rotation to get the current rotation, and here update it just the same way as before. Sorry. Okay. In controllers, we define mapping for different device inputs. Here, I'm getting the keyboard and an Xbox controller. And here, I define what will be our game controller. Our game controller will have a fire button and X-axis. And here, we make the mappings saying that this fire button is going to be a digital input that will map to the E key from the keyboard and the E button to the Xbox controller. So this way we will just check if the fire button is pressed, and we don't have to worry if it was from the keyboard, from the Xbox controller, Kinect, or whatever you want. And the same goes with X-axis. This is an analog 2D input, and it does just the same. And the same file, we define the game scenes. Okay, so here I'm making. Oh, sorry. The scenes have two important methods. First, the start, that is called when the entity is created, and then update, that is called in each tick of the game. Here I'm creating the previous cube, okay, and I'm calling its components to set the transform to the position 000. And in each update of the scene, I'm displaying the current FPS of the game. And settings.p, that is very important. It contains the game configuration and the system modules that we want to use. I want to explain that later. Here we set the game name, in this case my name, and the available resolution that our game will run. Here, for example, this resolution, among other settings. The one thing about this file is that here we can set which systems will the entity component system use. Here I'm using OpenGL, OpenAL, Bullet, and my own input from Kobra. So if I don't want to use physics, I just comment this, and my game won't have physics. I don't want to use Bullet, I want to use another physics library. I change it for everything. The rendering, the same. If I want to use DirectX, the same. So, as you can see, Kobra is very extendable, and you can just, it's very pluggable. The current status of Kobra is still in development. Okay, the beta will be available on December. If you want to help me with this, I will be glad, ready to want to work with you. My future goals are to implement a particle system through the scene editor. Vulkan support. Vulkan support. Do you know Vulkan? Anyone knows Vulkan? What is? Vulkan is the new graphics API that Kronos Group will release that will replace OpenGL in a short time. So I want to support it as well. And now I'm going to show you a simple Kobra demo. Okay. So. Okay. don't blame me. Okay. Oy, sorry. Wait. This. Okay. Well, I love Python tools for Visual Studio. Don't blame me. Okay. I will just run it, see if it works well. If it didn't work, fine, let's see. This is a game like Angry Birds, okay, but in 3D. We have the slingshot and our box, and in this example it's very easy. We just hold this space bar, and when we release it, okay, and you can see here that I'm getting a score for the boxes that are going outside. And this is just the example. So let's check the code. The code is very easy. You can see here the entities that I have. I have the red box that has a Cartesian transform to be placed in the world, mesh, rigid body, collider, and a score box behavior. This behavior, the only thing that it does is to check if it has gone outside I don't know how to say it, outside the area. Yes, thank you. Outside the area, we just add the score, and we print our score. You can see it's very easy. Here we have the player, that's just the same, but it has a player behavior, and this behavior, the only thing that it does is check if the space key is being pressed. If so, it charges up and moves backwards, and then if it's released, we send a message to apply that impulse to forward. You can see it's very easy. And this is all. Thank you for your attention. I hope you enjoy it. Questions? Yes.
Do you have Oculus Rift support, or are you planning in adding it?
I don't have Oculus support. Well, it would be a good idea, yes.
So what about
2D? 2D, it works as well. You can just use a car transform, but only moving around the X or Y axis. You can use just the screen transform, if you want. Any more questions?
Yeah.
Hi. Sorry.
So your message passing part is all in C, but then it's calling back into Python to execute the methods. So what is it just for the message passing that the GIL is released, or do you have like a lot of components written in C?
The components are written in C, yes, but you can also write components in Python if you want. The systems systems and the components can be programmed in C or Python. And if I understand your question, you're asking if all the messages are passed to all the entities, or sorry, to all the components. Performance.
Okay. You're not getting any performance benefits if your components are written in Python. You only get them if you're writing them in C. Is that right?
The without all the performance is that the renderer just runs in C, and that's the OpenGL calls that are the most expensive.
Right. So it's basically the rendering that is threaded.
Everything. You can just make a system in Python or in C, just as you want. And each system, as I explained, you can just put it in the settings, and it will just work. Any more questions? Yes.
How does the framework approach the transport lag problem? For example, you have a delay between client and server. If I fire a bullet from client and I have a lag, so is it possible with a framework to somehow approach that problem?
Yes. The components are a bit bound to the to the systems. Okay, so you have also to write the components for your system if they are not compatible. Any more questions?
I have one. Do you support Python 3?
In the future.
Make it a promise. Okay, do we have any more questions?
Thank you for the talk. Where can I find the source code?
The source code, I will upload it into my GitHub. I'm going to also make a web page. It will be available on December if you want to, or if you want, you can tell me your email and I will send to you if you want. But it's still in development. There are some things that need a bit of work. But if you're interested, I can send an email to you with the source you want.
Okay.
How do you see the future of Python game development, keeping in mind that there are a lot of high-quality free engines out there?
Well, I see it complicated. That's why I wanted to help Python to be a thing in video game with this framework. But I see a bit complicated in the future.
So we saw code to render a mesh. With what kind of shaders is that running? And is it like a kind of deferred rendering engine, or how you customize the shaders that rendering pipeline?
It's deferred rendering, yes.
And can you customize the rendering pipeline?
Yes.
Any more questions? Okay, so I'll ask, what platforms do you support?
I didn't try, but it's open source, so it can compile to any platform. I'm using Boost Python for the bindings of C++. The systems use their own DLL and so on, but. It's a bit complicated to port right now, but it works for Windows for the moment.
So no Android, for example?
Oh, for mobile, I'm not planning for being able to make games for mobile for the moment.
Okay, does anybody else have a question? All right, thank you.